and a half years than any other administration.
Tonight, all nine candidates lay out their vision for the Windy City. Cook County Commissioner Brandon Johnson.
The politics of old continues to leave the people of Chicago behind.
Congressman Jesus Chuy Garcia.
It's time for City Hall to work on behalf of all its people.
Alderwoman Sophia King.
We need somebody who can lead with collaboration and not confrontation.
Former CPS CEO Paul Vallis.
I'm going to campaign in every neighborhood. I'm going to respond to every question.
Businessman Willie Wilson.
I'm going to put my money where my mouth is.
State Representative Cam Buckner.
Being mayor of Chicago is about actually getting stuff done.
Alderman Roderick Sawyer.
This is a city that I love, city that I was born and raised in.
And activist Jamal Green.
And the young voters are going to decide this election.
Live from Chicago's Northwest Side and your local election headquarters, this is the 2023 Mayoral Forum.
Good evening and welcome to the 2023 Mayoral Forum. I'm Lourdes Duarte. This is brought to you by AARP in partnership with the Northwest Center, as well as the Hermosa Neighborhood Association.
And I'm Tahman Bradley. We are coming to you live tonight from Steinmetz College Prep in Chicago's Belmont Cragen neighborhood.
As you can see, the nine candidates are here tonight. They are standing in alphabetical order. They will each have 60 seconds, I should say, to answer each question unless otherwise noted.
Candidates, a reminder that this is a forum, not a debate. Not every candidate will be responding to every question. And while we won't allow rebuttals, we will be jumping in with follow-up questions where we see fit.
All right, so let's get started. Is everybody ready?
Yes.
Okay, we're going to start with the economy and finances. U.S. economists have been forecasting a recession or a rolling downturn in 2023. Mayor Lightfoot has said Chicago's economy is a great American success story. That's a quote. But critics point to several companies that have already left the city, including Boeing and Tyson. If elected, what steps would you take to protect Chicagoans in case of a recession? You each have 60 seconds. We're going to begin with State Representative Cam Buckner.
Good evening. Thank you for having us, and thank you for the question. When we look at Chicago's economy, and we look at where we are today and the threat of recession that is reigning over us right now, we have to have a clear plan on how we grow our economy and grow our city. I've put forth some very concrete plans and very concrete goals to grow Chicago to a population of 3 million people by the year 2030. We cannot continue to have City Hall fighting with our companies and our large organizations in this town and pushing them out and therefore pushing jobs out of the city. We have to do better. This mayor has done this with Boeing, she's done it with the Bears, and she has done it with corporations like McDonald's who have tried to stay here and they're trying to make it work. But Chicago needs to be welcoming in a way that can once again grow the economy and help us find ways to give jobs to people in this city so we can be thriving for the next 30 years, for the next 100 years.
Thank you. We move on to Congressman Jesus Chuy Garcia. Same questions. What would you do to protect Chicagoans in case of a recession?
Well, for one, I want to underscore that the U.S. Congress has been helping Chicago over the past 3 years during the pandemic. We provided $1.9 billion that kept the city afloat. We provided assistance to the Chicago Transit Authority and Metro. In the coming months and years, it will be very important to work with business leaders in Chicago to keep the Central Business District working and chugging along. Why? Because it will provide new opportunities for employment, especially in the areas of green manufacturing and technology. We can create pipelines for apprenticeships. It's critical to investment in neighborhoods in Chicago. And finally, I would say we need to work with World Business Chicago as well as the state's economic development entity.
Thank you. We move on to Jamal Green. Same question, 60 seconds.
Well, you know, Chicago's economy, it needs to grow. Right. And when we talk about growing that economy, we got to make sure that we're investing in small businesses. Right. And luring more small businesses to the city of Chicago to open. So the first business license should be free. We should have incentives for folks who want to open up businesses and streamline the process and make it easier to open up a small business. And we also got to create a new tax base. This is what we need to do with the funds we have right now from the federal government so that we can make sure that we're on a great path. We got to revitalize the Mag Mile and turn it into a strip of experiences and bring more corporate corporations downtown so we can have a tax base to stabilize Chicago. Then we got to create new homeowners in the community. We would use right now a single family mortgage bond to back 10,000 home loans each year, because we know that investing into people will create a new tax base and really help our economy going forward. We got to invest in homeowners, invest in small businesses, invest in the Mag Mile and downtown, and grow our economy that way and have a better future.
We move on to Cook County Commissioner Brandon Johnson. 60 seconds.
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you and good evening. Look, no one in this race has greater incentive for the city of Chicago to be better, stronger, and safer than someone who is raising their family on the west side of Chicago, particularly in Austin, one of the more violent neighborhoods in the entire city. And though we love it, we've experienced disinvestment. And in order to actually change and shift and have a better, stronger, safer Chicago, you have to invest in people. I'm the only person on this stage who've actually put forth a budget plan, where my budget plan is very simple. We reduce the deficit because of the failed politics that have gotten us here in the first place, while also making critical investments. In order to have a stronger, safer Chicago that no longer chokes the life out of businesses and those who actually live and work here, we have to put forth a plan that doesn't raise property taxes, by the way, to make sure that we're fully funding neighborhood schools, we're fully funding a reliable transportation system, healthcare, affordable housing. My budget plan reduces the deficit in my first term while making critical investments without raising taxes.
Thank you. Alderwoman Sophia
property
King.
Taxes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. Alderwoman Sophia King, your 60 seconds.
Thank you. So, you know, in order to grow our city, we need to have two things. We have to have safety, and we've got to have good schools. We have a plan to increase both of those off the bat. But the one thing we have to do is also stimulate growth downtown. We should really be the Silicon Valley of the Midwest, so we can attract jobs here. We're a great city. We're affordable. We're not San Francisco or New York. We have diversity. We have the infrastructure. We have the talent. We've got all of these universities around us. We need to create this ecosystem and prepare our youth for the jobs of the future, because that's where 75% of the jobs are going to be. So as mayor, I would seek to create us as the Silicon Valley of the Midwest and to prepare our youth for the jobs of the future and to make sure businesses can thrive here. And I would do that by leading with collaboration and not confrontation.
Thank you so much.
Thank
we move
you.
On to Mayor Lightfoot. 60 seconds. What would you do to protect Chicagoans in case of a recession? Mayor.
Well, let me tell you what we've done. Which is, we have the most diverse economy of any big city in the country. Whether it's manufacturing, transportation and logistics, life sciences, food and agriculture, our tech, and by the way, we are on the rise, we're tier one tech community. Our businesses are doing very well and survive the COVID-induced recession. Our businesses are doing so well that we exceeded our 2021 projections and 22 projections, so much so that we were able to prepay our pensions by the tune of $242 million. We've done a lot to protect small businesses, which we know are the heart of our economy. A $100 million loan fund that we stood up in the early days of the pandemic to keep those businesses afloat, keep their employees employed, and many more things. We also have been working hard to make sure that neighborhood corridors like our commercial corridors are vibrant. That's why Invest Southwest is so critically important. We've also done things to help workers, $15 minimum wage, and many other
and
things.
And your time is up. Thank you, Mayor. We move on to Alderman Roderick Sawyer. Same question, 60 seconds.
Thank you. In order to protect Chicago in case of a recession, you have to do a few things. First, protect your finances. Make responsible decisions, making sure that you're not doing any giveaways, and money that you spend are money that's supposed to be invested into the future of Chicago. Two, you protect the Central Business District. That's the driving engine that we need to have that operates a lot of our crucial functions in the city. That's how we pay for all the services that we get. Three, we protect, really important, our neighborhoods and our people. All 77 neighborhoods should be thriving. Everyone should be self-sustaining. That means that everyone should have their own stores, grocery, professional services, entertainment, children's activities, all self-sustaining, all without having the need to go downtown. And finally, safety. Obviously, safety. You want to make sure that we're protecting Chicago so people don't have that anxiety and further deepen the recession by not spending money in the city, which is also a key indicator. When we're spending money, we receive property tax revenue, and that's a positive thing for us.
Thank you, Alderman. Paul Vallis, we move on to you. 60 seconds.
Great. Your question is to prep for the recession.
For potential of a recession.
Exactly. So first, you have to really remove the obstacles to new businesses and new business expansions. There could be as many as 15 cranes in the sky, so to speak, instead of the one or two, if there wasn't that bureaucracy that slows down investment. Second, public safety. Public safety is not only impeding the ability of businesses to hire employees, but obviously it's impacting their ability to have customers come through the doors. Third, you've got to continue to provide support for those businesses that were not only impacted adversely by the COVID mitigations, but also those businesses that were impacted adversely by the unrest. And then fourth, you've got to cap property taxes, fees, and fines, because during a recession, the absolute worst thing you can do is to raise people's property taxes, to impose new fees, to impose new fines. So I think those four things, in combination with what some of my colleagues mentioned, additional things that you could do would, in fact, help prepare us for the next recession.
Thank you. We move on to Willie Wilson. Same question.
First thing we have to do is to make our city safe, grow our business base, cut taxes to attract business, set up a hardship program, make sure we take care of our citizens. When you cut taxes, people stay in the city, not shop outside the city. When you cut taxes, business stays in the city. When you cut tax and new business, you attract come into the city and you keep job. I'm a business person, so we know how to do that. And we do it all the time for a living. Yeah. The hardship program simply work this way, is that every piece of new business that comes in, we should tax the 3 to 5% onto the tax that it pays to the city of Chicago. A hardship program. When COVID-19 came, everybody, they closed down the business. I will not do that, period. You know, it's dumb, you know? Period, dumb. Keep them business open, do what you need to do to grow out business.
Thank you, Willie Wilson.
Candidates, from time to time tonight, we're going to gauge where you stand on key issues by simply asking you to raise your hands for 10 to 15 seconds. Let's give it a shot right now. With a show of hands, will anyone on this stage commit to not raising taxes if elected? Okay,
Which taxes?
Well, just taxes in general, and we'll get into specifics in a moment. Can you keep your hands raised, okay? All right, so we've got Buckner, Garcia, and Green. All right, for you, Willie Wilson, you continue to rail against taxes, as you just did, but on your website, you promise to funnel, in your words, money to the homeless, seniors, and churches. How do you plan to pay for that new spending? 60 seconds.
Well, the way you pay for it is that when you lower taxes, people stay in the city when you lower taxes. When you raise taxes, people move out their homes, other people buy their taxes. If you take a service station, for example, is gasoline 2% lower, you'll go to that particular service station. You attract more business. When you take and lower those taxes, people shop within the city, not outside the city. We got to get it. All the problem that we have, we need to stop trying to fix it by raising taxes on people. The city keep going down. So in order to grow something, you got to do something different, you know. So those particular things that you have to do different, you have to be bold, take leadership, and you have to deal with. Taxes is the wrong way of doing things, you know. You just can't make it that way. Business doesn't grow, nobody grows.
We're going to open this up to the rest of you. Roderick Sawyer, 60 seconds. Specifically, does your economic plan include new taxes, and what are they?
No, it does not. When I stated earlier, and I think that when you make responsible financial decisions, they should include tax planning strategies. When I say that, that means that we need to be looking. You asked a question previously about the recession. We should have professionals, and we do, and we need to have more professional financial people there to look at outcasts 5 to 10 years out, make determinations from that point, and sometimes that may require small tax adjustments. And that's all that is, 1-2% maybe on the property tax. And if financial situations look better, then we could talk about, you know, either no taxes or slightly reducing or even a rebate sometimes to Chicagoans. So this is what we talk about, a sound financial strategy. It is nothing, no smoke, no mirrors, just smart decisions made by smart people that advise me as mayor, and we want to make sure that happens under the Sawyer administration.
Cam Buckner, you raised your hand, 60 seconds. How are you going to execute your plans without raising taxes?
Listen, the city budget is opaque. I can guarantee you, if you go through the budget with a fine-tooth comb and have a real forensic audit, that you will find tons of efficiencies that we can use immediately and put those dollars where they belong, to actually invest in people and help people. I don't believe that nickeling and diming and raising taxes on the people of Chicago is the right thing to do, especially right now as we prepare for a possible recession. I've heard a lot from my colleagues about what they want to do moving forward, but going back to like a 1973 Richard J. Daley head tax is not the way to keep business in Chicago. It's not the way to ensure that our economy is moving in the right direction, and it's not the way to move this city forward.
Sophia King, does your plan include any new spending, and how are you going to pay?
No, so I agree. We can find efficiencies in our budget, stop, you know, gimmicky giveaways to make sure that our taxes aren't increased. But we need to grow our city in order to really make sure that our taxes are more livable. And the way to do that is to have safety and good schools. So we have a plan to grow good schools in the city of Chicago. As an educator, I know better that what good schools and the impact that they can have on communities, to expand selective enrollment with neighborhood components, also to grow our housing stock. We should take advantage of what I've been calling opportunity zones, which are out there where we can bring billions of dollars into our neighborhoods, mostly on the south and west side, and grow the housing stock around those good schools, and then take that tax increment that's there, TIF it, and then use that to put back into the community. So there are ways that we can grow our economy, grow our city without taxing people. But I certainly would look at efficiencies in our budget first.
Jamal Green, you raised your hand 60 yeah. seconds like everyone else. How yeah. are you going to pay for your plans without raising taxes?
So efficiencies is definitely one. One of the first things we're going to do is we're going to have a fiscal audit, a forensic audit on city's books first day in office. We're going to move that forward. And then we also want to grow our economy. So we're going to use a single-family mortgage bond, our bonding capacity, to back home loans and give down payment and closing cost assistance so that we have a new tax base that's coming back into the neighborhoods. And then we also going to implement a public bank in the city of Chicago where we have a bank charter that invests in home loans, in small businesses. All of the profit that comes back from that bank goes to city services. Property taxpayers cannot take it anymore. Taxpayers, period, can't take it anymore. I'm one of them. We just got an increase in our property taxes. And, you know, my colleague here, Brandon Johnson, just moved forward a plan to tax everything, right? And the reality of the situation is we can't have more taxes. Now, it was put in by Tony Preckwinkle. Hopefully, we don't get a sugar tax. We have to really make sure that we are not taxing folks out of town because people are leaving in an alarming rate, and we're going to stop that under our administration.
And I'm going to ask Mr. Johnson about his plan in just a moment. But Jesus Tree Garcia, you had your hand up. No new taxes?
No new taxes. First, it's really critical that we address the public safety issue, crime in Chicago, in order to attract investment. The city can't grow if there isn't additional investment. Investing has been going to other places like Phoenix and places in Texas and Miami, other parts of Florida. What we need is to work with the General Assembly to restore the levels of revenue sharing that Chicago used to have, the LGDF funding, and is critical. Back in 2011, it was higher. We need to restore it. The mayor came up short in her efforts to try to get it. It is critical to the well-being of the city, and we'll have other municipalities in Springfield working with us. Today, I urge the Federal Reserve not to increase interest rates anymore, because if they keep doing it, it will begin to produce unemployment. We can't afford that. We need to attract investment in Chicago.
Chicago, and having a safe city is the way to begin achieving that. I believe there's enough money in the budget to get us through for the next probably 2 years.
Thank you. Brandon Johnson, you are proposing $1 billion in new spending, and to pay for it, you back a list of new taxes, including a metro city surcharge, a mansion tax, and reinstating the $4 a month per employee head tax. Why should Chicagoans accept higher taxes? 60 seconds.
Well, first of all, let's talk about how we got here, because the failed politics of old that continues to leave people behind. Let's also be clear, I'm the only person on this stage who actually put forth a budget plan. It's a living document where the individuals who are going to vote on February 28th can begin to dissect it now. I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm always going to keep it 100 with the people of Chicago. You can't have a better, stronger, safer Chicago without investing in people. Listen, I've already found efficiencies in the budget because I've actually went through it. We can save $150 million by making sure that our administrative worker ratio reflects the rest of the country. $20 million we save by upgrading our tech system. We can save money by collaborating with Cook County government to make sure that mental health and health care costs are actually equitable. Look, we do all of that in my first term, reducing the deficit while making critical investments without raising property taxes. Listen, the people on the stage are either lying to the people of the city of Chicago or they're hiding the ball behind their back. They're gonna raise property taxes. I don't. You cannot.
Audience.
You cannot run a city government off of bake sales. I have a budget plan that invests in people while paying down our deficit. And that's what I'm committed to do, and that's why I'm transparent and open and honest about the people of Chicago.
Okay. All right. Take your time. A couple extra seconds if you need it, obviously.
No. Look, again, all I'm saying is that there are
people
on this.
We'll give you 15 seconds.
Yeah. All I'm saying is that the people on the stage here who do not believe that we can have a better, stronger, safer Chicago. The way you have a better, stronger, safer Chicago, you do what safe American cities do all over the country. They invest in people.
Okay.
You can't run a city government off of bake sales.
Okay.
You actually have to invest in people, and that's what my budget plan does. It invests in people.
All right. Thank you for that. Sorry about that interruption. Paul Vallis, you are out with a plan to create an independent community development authority and a municipal bank, moving investment decisions out of City Hall. This new entity will make try to revitalize left-behind communities. This sounds like a mix of Invest Southwest and the Emanuel Administration's Infrastructure Trust. How is this different than what's been tried in the past, and who will be in charge of these entities? 60 seconds.
Yeah, well, first of all, the Invest Southwest is warmed over Rahm Emanuel with some one-off projects. At the end of the day, what I'm talking about is creating an infrastructure that can really take politics out of investment on the South and West Side. It's real simple. You create an independent economic development authority that will drive investment, on the South and West Side, independent of the fifth floor, independent of things like aldermanic prerogatives. Secondly, you create an investment fund that provides for fair share. So you put a portion of the TIF money, the cannabis money, the gaming money when it becomes legalized, the sports betting money, the developer fees in that fund, so that investment authority has a vehicle. They have capital for equity investments, for gap financing, and things like that. And then the third thing is you expand the housing land bank to include an overall property land bank. So you're securing the miles and miles of inactive property, and you're making it available to developers fully remediated with long-term property tax abatements. That's how you create an infrastructure for development of South and West Sides.
All right, thank you. And Mayor Lightfoot, you canceled the property tax hike that was scheduled for the current fiscal year. You said at City Club last Friday that labor unions need to come to the table and make some hard choices on pensions. What exactly are you looking for them to give up?
Well, I don't think that's what I said. What I said is that we have climbed the pension ramp, and we are paying not just the bare minimum every year on our pensions, but we actually prepaid to the tune of $242 million. The question was, what more needs to be done? And I said that the solutions have to come in part from Springfield. We've got to bring the governor's office and the General Assembly together, along with our labor partners, and come up with long-term structural solutions to make sure that our promise of pensions to the 100,000-plus retirees and current city employees, that promise is real. but how you actually create economic development is what we've done. Over the last 2 years alone, in the middle of coming out of the COVID-induced recession, we had 353 companies make pro-Chicago decisions. That is, either come here from elsewhere or substantially expand their footprint, and particularly into Invest Southwest neighborhoods. Now, Mr. Vallis may say warmed over hash, but tell that to the people of Austin. Tell that to the people of Roseland and other places that where we have seen real economic development, and we are doing the work that needs to be done to restore vibrancy to neighborhoods.
All right, thank you.
Mayor, we're going to talk about crime.
I'm just wondering if you can speak up just a little
bit. Speak up just a little bit. We're going to talk about crime next. So we're moving out of finances, but the question will go to you first. Mayor Lightfoot, you point out that murders and shootings have gone down in the past year, which is true. However, when comparing crime stats to 2019, which is the year you took office, murders are up 78%. Shootings are also up 75%. Other than what's been tried already, can you name three new things that you would do if you are reelected?
Well, it's not what I will do in the future, it's what we are doing now. We are constantly evaluating options to do everything that we can to make Chicago the safest big city in the country, and making sure that our residents feel safe because they are safe. And a lot of that knowledge comes from listening to community members, particularly in those communities that have been long plagued by violence. So obviously the biggest threat that we have in our city is the proliferation of illegal guns. We've been working hard with our federal partners to stop the flow of illegal guns from places like Indiana and other surrounding states. Last year, the Chicago Police Department took 12,200 illegal guns off the street. We've also got to hold violent, dangerous, and habitual offenders responsible, which is why I keep pushing the courts in this city, in the county, to make sure that they are doing their part to keep the community safe. In addition to that, we have made sure that we're hiring more police officers. 956 hired last year, the highest number since 2017. We are promoted more detectives, 200, almost 300
Mayor,
in the last
few
years.
I'm going to stop you there, but I'm going to give you another 15 seconds. Can you talk about what new things you would do if you're reelected?
And I'm telling you what we are doing. We're hiring more. We're holding violent, dangerous people accountable. We're making sure that we're going into communities and helping uplift them. You can't just arrest your way out of the problem. So the other thing that we're doing is making concrete investments to stop the pipeline of young boys to the streets, which is also a substantial challenge that we face in
Chicago.
Thank
you, Mayor. We're going to move on to Paul Vallis. Can you name three new things that haven't been tried already that you would do to fight crime?
Look, the first thing I would do is replace Brown and his leadership team and really end the friends and family promotion system that promotes people in positions of leadership who have not had the time and grade. The second thing I would do is return to interim superintendent Charlie Beck's strategy of community-based policing, that is pushing the police officers down to the local beats so that there are cars covering local beats. And WirePoints reported last year, in a report that they did last year, that there were 400,000 high-priority 911 calls that were not responded to because there was not a car available at the time. The third thing that I would do is put the police on a normal work schedule and, incidentally, allow them and encourage them to be responsive. That would, in turn, slow the exodus. The police department lost another 1,000 officers this year after the 1,000 officers that they had lost the previous year. And then the fourth thing I would do is I would invite retired officers to return, and I would invite those officers who have left to return under the new leadership without loss of seniority when they left. I think those are some new things among the many things I've recommended.
Thank you. We move on to Cam Buckner. Same question, 60 seconds.
Yeah, I want to get straight to it, to the people of Chicago. For those of you who are in the market for a new mayor, and according to most polls, 70% of you are, I would guarantee that most of you do not feel safer today than you did 4 years ago. This mayor was just asked a question about what she would do different, and she doubled down on her failed policies. That is the Lightfoot way. Double down on failed policies will give us a doubled murder rate. We have to do better. What I've talked about is making sure that we increase the amount of resources and money that goes to our violence prevention, gun violence prevention programs, making sure that we increase the number of detectives so we can actually increase our clearance rate, and that we are putting the resources where they need to go. And I've also talked about opening up our mental health clinics. Listen, we are at the bottom of every list that we should be on the top of, and at the top of every list that we should want to be on the bottom of. What we're doing is not working, and don't let this mayor double down. Let's do better.
Thank you. We move on to Jamal Green. Same question. What three new things
would
you do?
Can I just interrupt for 10
seconds? No, this is a forum. This is a forum, not a debate.
You will have more time when the next question comes up. Okay. Jamal Green, 60 seconds.
I really wish that our mayor would just stop lying to the people and just be honest, right? We need to make sure that we have a mayor that is able to step up and say what we're doing is not working and we're going to try new things. So we're going to do plenty of things. One of the things is we're going to put $100 million into Alternative Response Agency of social workers to respond to mental health calls to free up police. We're also going to dedicate $30 million to a youth intervention department so that there are youth interventionists to put young people on the right path. We're also going to reopen up all of the mental health facilities that were closed down to tackle mental health holistically. We're going to also have a reentry program embedded in Cook County Jail as well as into the Department of Corrections so that we can make sure that folks who come home have the resources and the support that they need. We're also going to invest in a block club infrastructure program so that we can organize block clubs all across the city, because when you invest in people, they can police themselves on their blocks, and those are the first responders, is the people on the blocks, and that's how we're going to have public safety in this city.
From you, we move on to Alderman Roderick Sawyer. Same question, three new things.
First thing I would do is rely upon the community commission that we've had just established, that I was proud to be the lead sponsor of, to make sure that we get them in place, connect with the community so that we can work on the resulting fact is increasing our clearance rates, reducing crime. We have to also improve the health of our officers. If we want healthy officers out here doing the job that we expect them to do, let's increase the mental health services and behavioral health services to them, making sure that they're safe in their own environments. We also have to work with youth. When we talk about most of our crime, we're talking about youth-involved crime. Let's not look at a youth-involved solution. Let's look at things like Good Kids, Mad City's Peace Book Ordinance. Let's do a sample of that. Let's see how it works. Let's put them in charge of an area where they can have real change going on, making sure that they do the things that are necessary and they can see for themselves how this really works. And I would do that because we're just spinning our wheels here. We talk about crime all the time, but we're not getting down to the root of the problem. The root of the problem is engaging with youth.
Sophia King, same question goes to you. Three new things.
So I do agree with my colleague. Youth engagement is an important piece of this. But safety also, we have a plan that this mayor and anybody else should implement right away. We have a plan that puts up to 50% more officers in all of our communities just by changing the shift, going to a four-day on, three-day off workweek, which, by the way, gives the officers the mental health, the rest that they need. We should be doing this right now. Another thing, violence intervention. We should be spending hundreds of millions of dollars on violence intervention. We gave this mayor $85 million. She hasn't spent $5 million yet in 2022. So we're moving that money into 2023. That's a shame. We need to get to that. We also know that over 50% of calls to 911 are for nonviolent issues like mental health insecurities, like homeless issues. We need to have an alternative response to that. We put a pilot in the street. This mayor has not escalated that pilot in a fulsome way. So we have things that we can do immediately to make sure that our communities are more safe. And as mayor, I would do that.
And I'm going to go to Mayor Lightfoot again, just because three of the candidates mentioned you by name. So I want to give you 15 seconds. Cam Buckner said you doubled down on failed politics. Jamal Green said you are lying to the people. 15 seconds.
Well, first of all, it's easy to come up here and say sound bites, but what I didn't hear is any actual concrete solutions. And many of the things that we did hear were things that we're already doing. Alternative response. If you had voted for the budget, Sophia King, then you would have a right to stand here and say something about that. We have made sure that we've done everything that we can to hire new officers, empower new detectives, new solutions. We are constantly doing that to do everything we can to keep people safe and making sure that we fund the mental health. $20 million
we are
in funding for mental health.
Thank you, Mayor. We're going to move on to the next question. You're going to have time in the future questions to take up some of the time for your answer. So let's move on to Mr. Garcia. Mayor Lightfoot and Brandon Johnson say your public safety plan was copied from Mayor Lightfoot's. Walk us through how you came up with that plan and how it's different. 60 seconds.
I'll tell you how I came up with that plan. I am the only candidate in this race
who has created and run violence prevention programs in Chicago streets. We work with gang-involved youth, we work with parents, we work with schools, we work even with the police. That is the qualification that I bring. What I would do differently is what the mayor has failed to do, and that is I would fire Superintendent Brown. He's a failure, everyone knows it. People have even run away from him. Two, I would invest in violence prevention programs. Three, I would ensure that we get to work on building trust between community residents and the police force. They need to get out of the cars. They need to talk to people. I think the representatives from the district councils can be a great bridge to that, to ensure that there is both safety and justice in our policing. We also have to train police officers so that we don't see the types of incidents that we saw recently in Memphis.
Thank you, Congressman Garcia. We move on to Willie Wilson. You talked about taking the handcuffs off Chicago police and allowing them to hunt down criminals like rabbits. What does constitutional policing mean to you? 60 seconds.
I can't hear you quite clearly.
I'll ask it again. You talked about taking the handcuffs off Chicago police and allowing them to hunt down criminals like rabbits. That's a quote. What does constitutional policing mean to you?
Public, let me say this, if I'm hearing you right. It being public safety a person to me allows a kid that was 20 years old, right? From gun violence. We have to back out police officer. We have to take the handcuffs off them. We got to take all these different rules and things off them. The present administration have failed. Who going to try to do work and get the city right and public safety when they don't, when they turn it back against the administration? They seem to have complaint. You don't take then hire and pay a person to complain. You pay a person to fix it. We fix the job, get it done. We have to make our citizens safe at all costs.
Thank you, Willie Wilson. We move on to Brandon Johnson. 60 seconds to answer this next question. Following the murder of George Floyd, you introduced a resolution that called for redirecting funds from police to social services. If elected mayor, what specific cuts do you plan to make to the Chicago police budget? 60 seconds.
Yeah, well, first of all, violence in the city of Chicago is a very serious problem. We're all experiencing it. I've said this repeatedly. My wife and I, we've had to cover our children multiple times as gunshots have rang right outside our front door. This is not something that simply happens on the news. We live it and experience it every single day. And what I've said repeatedly, that if you want a safe city, you do what safe American cities do all over the country. They invest in people. That's what I've done as a Cook County Commissioner, hundreds of millions of dollars into violence prevention, right? We've also invested in the largest expansion of the guaranteed universal basic income, eliminating medical debt. These are the things that are necessary to keep a community safe. You know, look, I've said this repeatedly. There's a direct correlation between youth employment and violence reduction. I'm a teacher. I've looked into the eyes of young people when they're not seen. They're going to be seen in my administration. We're going to have a year-round hiring program. We're going to pass Treatment Not Trauma to free up law enforcement. Over 40% of the violent crimes that happen in the city of Chicago happen in 6% of the city. We need someone who is smart and someone who actually has a consciousness to actually invest in people. My administration does that.
Candidates, some of you have already mentioned this. We'll do another raise of hands. If elected, would you keep Superintendent David Brown in charge of CPD? I know Chuy Garcia and Paul Vallis said you would fire him. So would you keep David Brown at CPD? Raise your hand for a few seconds for us. Mayor Lightfoot, we're going to, was that a yes for you, Willie Wilson? Yes on keeping David Brown?
I don't think it, David Brown. I think you need to fire the mayor. She's in charge.
Okay, all right. And Mayor Lightfoot, your hand is up. We'll go ahead and give you 30 seconds. Keeping David Brown. Why keep him?
Well, first of all, let me say there are two defunders of the police that are on this stage. Chuy Garcia, the original one, in 2011, he slashed the sheriff's budget, slashed adult probation, and created a crisis. Brandon Johnson wouldn't answer your defunding question, because the reality is that you can't do that if you want to keep people safe. People want to make an issue about David Brown, but fundamentally what this is about is what are the strategies that we are using to keep people safe. The strategies that we are using are working. Are we there yet at the finish line? Absolutely not. But when you see homicides plummet by 14%, you see shootings plummet by 20%, carjackings down 10%, you are on the right path.
Okay, and so Brandon Johnson sort of had an opportunity to answer that already. I want to bring in Chuy Garcia into this conversation.
Say 30 seconds.
Well, you know, we specifically asked you about it. Chuy Garcia, the mayor says you support defunding the police. Yes or no? Is that true?
That's totally false, among many other things that she says. If people want to fact check, they should ask the chief judge if any of those funds were cut. They should also ask the sheriff of Cook County if at any point during my commissionership I sought to do that. It is one of the other lies that she keeps perpetuating. She's always creating smoke screens to try to cover up her own failures.
Okay, several candidates in this race have talked about increasing the size of the Chicago Police Department, but last summer the Civic Federation found that only about 90% of the department's sworn officer positions are currently filled, and we learned that last year CPD lost about 1,000 officers. Sophia King, you've proposed rehiring retired officers to help fill those vacancies. Specifically, what incentives would you give to entice people to come back to the force?
So,
60 seconds.
You know, first of all, you know, we do have, you know, folks who want to defund the police, folks who want law and order. We have to realize that most people sit in the middle. We can uplift our police. We can hold them accountable. We can have safety and justice. We understand that. The incentives that I would bring is to make sure that they come to our neighborhoods, the most under-resourced neighborhoods. I would incent them with low interest or no interest mortgages. I would sent them with down payment assistance so that we can also grow our communities at the same time. I think, but most of all, I would seek to appreciate them and uplift them and tell them, you know, that we, they're our brothers, our sisters, humanize them, but they're not the only response, you know, that we need for this violence. We have to also fund violence intervention in a meaningful way. So I would hope, there are two professions where we lay everything at their feet that we are unable to solve, police and teachers. We also have to take some of that pressure off of them and do the things that they're not trained to do, like alternative responses to policing.
Okay,
so those are some of the things I would do.
Thank you. Kim Buckner, you've said you want to get rid of unnecessary restrictions on police hiring. Specifically, what restrictions would you lift?
Listen, I'm talking about the racially insensitive restrictions, like the restrictions on a credit score. There are young black and Latino men walking around the city who want to be a part of the solution, but they're being told by CPD because their FICO score is not up to par that they cannot serve their community. These are arbitrary. They should not be the case. I just also want to say that the mayor continues to say that what we're doing is working. And for those of us who have seen bullets rip through the flesh of people in this city, for those of us who have taken a long walk from Hearst to grave sites at Burr Oak and Oakwood and Mount Hope Cemetery, this is not okay. What, we cannot trivialize these people's lives. What we're doing is not working, and we need to change. The mayor needs to pivot. We all need to pivot and find a real way to deal with crime and safety and justice in this city so we can be an effective city and move us forward.
We're going to go to Brandon Johnson next. If elected, how specifically will you fill the roughly 1,600 already vacant CPD positions?
Well, again, you need someone who's willing to tell you the truth. The fact of the matter is, everyone on this stage is calling for the expansion of the police budget. We have spent more on police per capita than anywhere else in the world. Ask ourselves, do we feel any safer? We don't. We have to do what safe American cities do all over this country. We invest in people. The defunder on the stage is actually Mayor Lori Lightfoot and Paul Vallis. They've defunded our public schools. They've defunded our mental health services. They've defunded transportation, defunded access to affordable housing. If you were to refer to me as anyone, refer to me as the investor in chief, because it's not enough to love the city of Chicago without loving his people. Look, listen, we are struggling in this city with an unprecedented amount of trauma. We can actually cut costs within the police budget by making sure, again, the staff to worker ratio is actually on par with the national averages. Asking retired police officers after 30 years of service to go back on the front line without a clear vision and plan is irresponsible. That's why I'm committed to investing in people, because that's what safe American cities do around this country.
Thank you, Mayor Lightfoot. To you next. We know you're working on this. Can you get it done? Can you increase the number of officers on CPD, and how are you going to do it?
Well, what we have done is stood up a full-time recruiting team that literally goes all across the country to HBCUs, working with the military branches when people are leaving the military. We've looked and diagnosed every aspect of the hiring process, from the application to the time that folks get into the academy, to see whether there are any weaknesses in that. We've made adjustments in the hiring criteria, so we bring more people in. That has resulted in historic numbers of people that are applying, and the yield that we got last year is good. It's 956, almost 1,000, keeping pace with the number of officers who have retired. We've got to keep doing more, and we've got to show people that we support our police, that we aren't going to be defunders, that we care about their mental health, and continue to invest the $20 million that we put forward for hiring clinicians and other social workers to help our police and their families. That's the way that we do it. But fundamentally, what we've got to say to our young officers who are out there, thank you for your service.
All right, thank you. Roderick Sawyer, how do you increase the size of CPD?
A few things, and I'm not necessarily subscribing to increasing. I want to right-size it. I want to right-size it by making sure that whoever the superintendent is can advise me about scheduling, about manpower, where the shortages or overages occur. I need a professional at the top of the police department that can give me good advice to make sure that we're doing the right things. But a couple of other things real quickly. One of the things I was proud to do, it was not an ordinance, it was not a resolution, but it was a practice working with Department of Personnel and other aldermen last term. We worked on making sure that youthful offenders, I'll call them youthful indiscretions, things that occurred that people later on apply for the police department, they get knocked out for. And I was listening to Representative Buckner talk about credit score, which is one of the things that we brought forth, and I got a very interesting answer in response, and I just wanted to share it because I thought it was important. The reason that we still deal with credit scores, for example, is to prevent people being compromised based on, you know, owing money to certain things and people offering them something in exchange. It was to relieve some kind of lure to unethical activity. So, yes.
Willie Wilson, we know you want police to be able to do their jobs. About 1,000 vacancies. How do you, 1,600, I should say, how do you increase, how do you attract people to make them want to be Chicago police officers?
Raise the pay, raise the retirement age temporarily, suspend the tests that they have to take. I do not support and feel you should defund the police. You know, you should be trying to give them raises, you know, things of that nature. Take the policy off them, restriction off them. Cover their back and let them know that they're covered. Vacation days, give them off. Shorten their days, making sure that they can be with their family. You know, treat them like they are. They're the people who protect us, you know. And we should treat them like they're VIP, you know. And we should maybe get the morale and everything up. We'll hire more police officer there. You got about 300 police officers on administrative. Take them, put them into the cars, and then take the ones that retired who work in these jobs, put them in there, let them do administrative work.
All right, Jesus Chuy Garcia, 60 seconds.
Failed leadership has gotten us to this point where people don't have faith in the department. It's because of failed leadership. For one, I would, of course, get a new superintendent, but I would also entrust the superintendent to ensure that we take the citywide patrols and make them neighborhood patrols. That gets you more bodies on the streets, with an emphasis on training, with an emphasis on building and rebuilding trust between community residents and police officers. Very, very important. In addition to that, we can hire more civilians so that civilians are doing administrative work and get more bodies, again, uniformed police officers on the street. A second way to produce more more manpower where it is needed most. And lastly, we need to prioritize violent crime. Very, very critical. That's what people in all neighborhoods want. And lastly, as we make the embrace of a modern police department and a reliance on data to drive our decisions, that is how we become much more efficient and impactful.
Thank you. Paul Vallis, how do you fill the vacancies at CPD?
Well, first of all, you slow the exodus. When you lose 2,000 officers in 2 years, you've got an exodus problem. And you don't. And that won't be accomplished until you have new leadership, until you have a community-based policing strategy, and you get the police officers on a normal schedule. How do you fill the vacancies in the meantime? Well, you fill the vacancies by inviting retired officers to come out of retirement return. You can incentivize them with health care and other incentives. There's also hundreds of officers who will return if there's new leadership. But they've been de facto told that they have to go through the academy again, or in some cases they've even claimed that they've been told that they can't be a member of the police union. So at the end of the day, you can invite officers to return. Plus, there's something like there's hundreds of officers in the fire department that could easily be part of a police department reserve. So when you are in emergencies and there's shortfalls. And then finally, the CTA. I mean, we're spending $100 million in private security on the CTA, 300 private security officers that don't have the power of arrest. That money could hire as many as 300 additional officers.
Jamal Green?
You know, first, it is disgusting that we have a 70-plus-year-old man on this stage who is a sharecropper from down south who would get on TV and constantly double down on hunting people down like rabbits. He should know what that means and know how it feels. And when you have that mentality that Willie Wilson has, you have Tyre Nichols, you have George Floyd's, you have Anjanette Young's. We cannot have that in this city. We should not even be continuing to talk about expanding the police budget. And since Lori is so pro-police, when I'm mayor this year, I hire her as one. We have to really tackle the real root causes of what's going on, and that is our young people. Schools should be open throughout the day and on weekends with programming. Young people should have year-round apprenticeships, 13 years old to 25. Our kids are smarter than Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos, but we have to invest in those young people and make them fulfill their fullest potential, and that's what we're going to do in our administration, not continue to talk about how we're going to expand the police department.
Willie Wilson, J-Mo Green threw a punch there. 30 seconds.
Well, I don't respond to kids. but I will respond to the mayor tonight. She's more concerned about people who killing people out here and caught than people who's out here living a life and trying to make a living. She's more concerned about calling somebody a rabbit when people put themselves down like animal, that shot my kid, killed somebody else, and gonna look and kill somebody else out here soon. Your mother, your father, is wrong.
All right.
That's what I got to say about the mayor.
All right.
We are going to stay on this topic of crime. The next question is for you, Mayor, so you can use that however you see fit.
No rebuttal here.
You have overseen the encryption of police scanners, citing concerns about the safety of first responders. With transmissions moving to a 30-minute delay, there are concerns official records can be edited, and the public will not know about crime on their block until well after it happens. Will you stand by this policy if you are reelected?
Well,
30 seconds.
First of all, Mr. Wilson, when you say that you're going to hunt people down and allow the police people to hunt people down like rabbits, you're talking about black and brown boys in our city. And it's offensive. I can't believe you continue to say it. But that is really what you're talking about here. And you have no concern for their lives, but I do. And going back to the encryption, part of the reason that we're concerned is as a result of the challenges that we see with people blowing whistles, sending cops on false 10-1s. And so we have a policy that allows for our police officers to respond in the first instance to protect themselves, but also protect the community.
I'm going to give you another 15.
That was directed at me.
I'm going to give you another 15 seconds. Are you worried, though, that people on their own block, in their own neighborhood, will not know for 30 minutes, well after a crime happens, that, you know, police are coming to that scene, that there's a shooting in their neighborhood?
In the days of social media, cameras everywhere, and people constantly talking about issues that are happening on their block, there's lots of different ways in which people will know. And by the way, the citywide transmissions are not going to be encrypted, as we have told the media. This is about making sure that we protect first responders and we protect the victims in the crime so the police can get there, start the investigation, and make sure that we're chasing down the people who are committing crimes.
We'd like to get everyone else on the record on this issue. With a show of hands, if you are reelected, will you keep police scanner transmissions delayed to the public? Raise your hands.
Oh, yes. I think that was directed at me. I should have an opportunity to respond.
Let me finish this. So the only person raising their hand that will continue the delay is Mayor Lightfoot. Is that correct?
Say again?
The only person who will continue the delay on the scanners is Mayor Lightfoot.
Well, first of all, we haven't started it yet. We're still open to negotiations. But as I said, the citywide, which are the major events and things happening in the city, those are always going to be open,
Mayor,
and not encrypted.
We're going to move on to education.
Yes, candidates, it's 7:54. You're doing a great job sort of turning this into a debate. We appreciate it. Chicago Public Schools has lost 87,000 students since 2009, but the district is collecting $2.5 billion more from state and local taxpayers than it did a decade ago. So what is your specific plan to enrich the educational experience of CPS students? You'll each have 60 seconds. Willie Wilson, we will start with you.
You know what? I want to respond to this here.
You can use your time however you wish.
Okay, I just responded to this here. And I want to say this here too, make it clear, you know. We losing people every day that getting killed to crime. We didn't put the handcuffs on people. When I said a person to hunt down like a rabbit, if the person put themselves down there like animal, them kill people, well, they put themselves down there, all right? And if this particular mayor here ain't done nothing about it, people still continue to kill people. Nobody get caught, but she's still protecting. She need to get out of office, and she's gonna be put out of office. This thing is serious. If somebody come and kill somebody in her family, then she would know how to feel. I want to look, we're trying to protect our citizens that living by the law. Whether it's black and brown, I don't care. We're not black and brown. We're black and brown, white and Asian. We're all Chicago.
Okay, all right. Let's, Cam Buckner, 60 seconds. Our topic is education. Give us your specific plan to enrich the educational experience of CPS students.
Yeah, well, first I'll say that my campaign is one of the only ones to have rolled out a standalone, specific, concrete education plan. And what we talk about in that plan is making sure we're doing the right things, right? Increasing funding so that we are putting dollars in our schools based on the need and not on the population, which I've done in Springfield. Being able to work with the new elected representative school board, which I helped fight for in Springfield, to make sure that we are doing the things that our young people need to have a successful school experience. I also talk about putting a social worker, a librarian, and a nurse in every single Chicago public school to make sure that our young people are able to benefit from that. And bringing forth the sustainable school model, bringing back trades and vocational learning in our schools, and making sure that we are giving our young people a holistic education so they can compete in the global economy.
Thank you. Brandon Johnson, 60 seconds for you.
Yeah, well, as mayor of the city of Chicago, you're actually going to finally have a mayor who actually believes in public education.
All right, audience, help us out and be respectful here. You're going to be removed. Go ahead.
Well, first of all, the fact that I'm already being protested and I'm not the mayor of the city of Chicago yet, that's pretty impressive. Mayor Lightfoot, I know how you feel now. But the truth of the matter is, you have to have someone who's committed to investing in public education. We have individuals in this city who attend public schools, who show up in neighborhoods where violence is pervasive. Michelle Clark, many students have been, the number of students have been murdered at Michelle Clark just this year alone. Benito Juarez, Kenwood, my child is a student there. And the third week in the school, one of the classmates at Kenwood steps outside, go to lunch, and is murdered. That's why you actually have to have someone who has a full vision for the city of Chicago. I'm the only person on this stage that put together a full budget plan that calls for investments. No one else has done that. I'm committed to a better, stronger, safer Chicago by fully investing in our public schools.
So, folks,
politics ain't.
This is not fair. Mr. Johnson has a right to talk without interruption.
Agreed.
So,
absolutely.
You need to do something.
No,
to get
we absolutely agree.
It's not fair.
We should get in the
our security is going to take care of that. But let's our security is going to take care of that. But so thank you. Politics ain't beanbag. We appreciate you all running and of course serving. Jesus Chuy Garcia, 60 seconds. Education. How are you going to enrich the experience for CPS students?
The loss of the population in Chicago is expressed in the exodus of students from our school system. COVID complicated that. We've got to do everything possible to identify and try to bring back those students who have fallen through the cracks. Very important. We need to try to make up what was lost during COVID with the general student population. But two, we need to restore the confidence that schools can flourish and be a good place for all families in Chicago. Toward that end, I would work with community groups to open up more schools after school hours. I've done it. I've done it as an executive director of an organization that spearheaded this type of movement, and it exists in many parts of the city of Chicago. Getting those schools open in less privileged communities is a priority. We need to increase the funding for schools as well. We need to convince people that we can have good public education for children everywhere in Chicago.
Thank you. Mayor Lightfoot, your plan, 60 seconds.
Well, first of all, we need our fair share of funding from Springfield. That's number one. We need to make sure that we fulfill our contractual obligations with the teachers union and the other unions, which we are doing and on track. We need to make sure that we fulfill the plan enacted by CEO Martinez to make sure that every single school has a baseline of programming, whether it's the arts, whether it's math, whether it's science. We are well on our way to meeting those needs. And I've heard from several people here, well, the schools need to be open after hours. Guess what they are? They need to be open on the weekends. They are. But they also continue the partnership that they have with the parks and with the libraries. It takes a holistic approach of government, not just on the backs of CPS, to make sure that our children are having a fulfilling, enriching experience in their in-school time and their out-of-school time. That is what we've supported. Those are the fundings that we have invested in our kids, their families, and our neighborhoods to make sure that that happens.
Roderick Sawyer, you also get 60 seconds.
Thank you. What we need to do is reimagine what schools look like. When we have a school like Frederick Douglass School that's less than 5% populated and 0% proficiency in key subjects, we have to reimagine that. When we're spending more than most people spend on graduate school for each one of these students here, we have to do better. We have to be focused on putting all available resources towards educating our children. That includes eliminating all the bloat that may be at CPS, if there is any. We're going to look at it very thoroughly. If there's bloat there, we'll get rid of it. We want to make sure that even though I do support the moratorium on closings up until 2025, we need to start looking at what new schools look like. Schools that have all the appropriate things in there, librarians, extracurriculars, all the things that we expect our children to have, and additionally, social and emotional support. Schools in certain areas, you know, in addition to trying to compete academically, they have to be in a school to be clean, to worry about whether they're going to get there safely, if they're going to get shot or not. We have to worry about all these things for education to succeed.
All right, Paul Vallis, 60 seconds.
Well, first of all, as someone who put so many magnet programs in the neighborhood schools and expanded the school day, kept the campuses open, and to such an extent that we actually had 125,000 more students than they have today. We also built 78 schools and never had to close a single school. The bottom line is I would apply the things that we did then now. And basically it was this, force the money down to the local schools. Right now only about 60% of the dollars actually find its way to the local schools in classroom instruction. They're spending $30,000 a kid. Open the campuses through the dinner hour on weekends, over the holidays. I'm sorry, not all the campuses are open, and invite community-based organizations to bring their programs in. Create universal work study in all the schools. Have every city agency, department, contractors, the unions who the city partners with create paid work study jobs for all the kids so that they can be engaged. engaged in safe and secure places, and finally, reclaim the kids that have left by expanding the alternative schools network. We have tens of thousands of students who have exited who are not going to return, and they need to be brought back through alternative schools.
Thank you. Sophia King, 60 seconds.
Yes. As a former teacher and educator, I know all too well what we need to do in education. We have a plan that seeks to incentivize teachers. If our teachers aren't incentivized and they're leaving our city faster than police are, then we won't have good schools. We also need to bring trades back to the schools in a fulsome way so that our kids can be prepared for the jobs of the future, whether it's in the trades or in the tech industry. We need to engage our youth. There's no reason, K through 12, why we shouldn't have year-round after-school programming for our kids. And finally, I would expand selective enrollment with a neighborhood component. The school, Kenwood, that he sends his kid to has a selective enrollment 7th and 8th grade program, and then its high school opens up to the neighborhood. It has grades like Jones High School downtown, which is purely selective enrollment. So we've sought to increase resources for schools like that. That's what I would do, increase schools like that throughout the city so that everybody had an opportunity to get a good education.
Jamal Green, in your education plan, you've proposed universal 3K. That would be for all three-year-olds in the city. How are you going to oversee that program? How much will it cost? And how do you recruit staff when CPS is already facing a teacher shortage? 60 seconds.
Yeah, of course, this is an important issue, right? If we start to educate kids as young as 3 years old in the city of Chicago, data has shown that throughout their life, they are less likely to engage in crime. We want universal 3K implemented all throughout our schools throughout the city of Chicago. Obviously, we'll have to pilot it so that we can figure out the funding to put it in every school. So that's one of the things that we will commit to our first year as a pilot program in certain schools throughout the city of Chicago. Every kid in the city of Chicago deserves a quality education. We have to move CPS from enrollment-based formula to needs-based formula and invest in these institutions. There's no reason why schools should be low on enrollment and then we shut them down and leave these buildings all throughout our neighborhoods. This is a travesty. Every kid needs a high-quality education, no matter the neighborhood. You should not, if you are poor or have a certain income, that shouldn't determine the education of your kid. And we're going to change that in the city of Chicago, starting as young as 3 years old.
Thank you. We are going to stay on this topic of education. There's a bill waiting for the governor's approval that will give collective bargaining rights to Chicago public school principals. The Chicago Teachers Union, as you know, has feuded with the city's mayors for more than a decade. There will also be a shift to an elected school board by 2027. Can you tell us about a specific time that you have been successful in negotiating something, anything? And what approach will you use with all three of these groups? And we're going to begin with Brandon Johnson, 30 seconds.
Yeah, well, first of all, I come from a family of 10. We grew up in a house with one bathroom. So I learned to negotiate really early in life, especially with my sisters. You have to have a collaborative spirit. The reason why we have an elected representative school board is because I was a lead organizer to bring that into fruition. District council races that will ultimately provide civilian oversight over policing. That's part of the work, that's part of the movement that actually propelled me into this particular position. Here's the last thing. The fact that we actually have a stage full of people of color who are identifying as progressives, that's success. Now, we have one person on the stage that's trying to convince folks that he's a Democrat. But other than that, there's something to be hopeful about, to know that the city of Chicago is prepared for a better, stronger, safer Chicago. And I'm confident, of course, that my leadership reflects
Brandon
that.
Brandon Johnson, thank you. They gave you a little bit more time because of the interruption earlier. We want to move on to Sophia King. When is a time that you've negotiated something, anything, been successful, and how would you approach these three groups?
So, you know, I think that's what sets me aside from a lot of folks who are on this stage is that I lead with collaboration and get things done. I led, actually, the $15 minimum wage hike that everybody is trying to claim. We got people around the table who agreed, who disagreed, and we came to something that became a national model. We also know that $15 is not enough. Leading the Michael Reese development, there are four striking developments in the city of Chicago, 78, Lincoln Yards, the Obama library. We're the only one where there wasn't public dissension.
Thank
so
you,
I've been
Alder
leading
woman.
With collaboration
we
and
move
getting
on
things done.
To Paul Vallis, same question, 30 seconds.
You know, I've negotiated collective bargaining agreements with just about every public union, type of union that you can imagine, including, Brandon, four collective bargaining agreements with the unions in the largest cities in four different states. And I've never had a strike. I've never had a rain delay, so to speak, never had a delay in the startup. And I don't recall ever having a grievance. In fact, I raised teacher salaries in the Chicago Public Schools 21% compounded, and fully left their pensions 104% funded. So I think that's a track record of success when it comes to collective bargaining.
Thank you. Let's move on to Cam Buckner.
Yes, listen, I have a result in the background that shows you that I can work with people and get things done across the aisle as well. Listen, I was the chief negotiator on the most comprehensive and consequential clean energy climate change legislation in the history of this country, bringing folks together to get that done. I did the same thing helping Illinois become the ninth state in the union to ban deadly assault weapons just a few weeks ago. I do this every single day. And with all due respect to my brother Brandon, he wasn't in Springfield in those back rooms when people from downstate were refusing to vote for the representative school board bill, and I pushed them over the top to do it, and I negotiate with a 13-month-old every single night.
We move on to Jesus Chuy Garcia. Same question, 30 seconds. What will your approach be?
I've negotiated in many circumstances, one in the back of the yards, a fight for a new school, the Richard J. Daley School, with Gary Chico. We signed the agreement at CPS. Two, I've negotiated non-retaliation truces with conflicting gangs and communities. And last, I am negotiating with staff in Congress who are seeking to form a union.
Jamal Green, we move on to you. You also have 30 seconds to answer this question.
Well, I've been a community organizer for over 10 years now in the city of Chicago, and I've helped to negotiate plenty of things, whether it's the consent decree. We brought communities together all across the city to talk about what real police reform looks like. I've also been in the communities settling gang disputes with the different cliques in the neighborhoods and make sure that we have peace during the pandemic. I've also brought together money for businesses who were looted during the pandemic, and we brought together $250,000 to get businesses back open. So I've always been collaborative with everyone in the city.
Moving on to Roderick Sawyer.
In addition to street organization disputes I negotiated back 30 years ago, I have to correct Representative Garcia. He's not the only one that has been working in the streets. I was been working in the streets 30 years ago doing this type of work in front of the toughest people you can imagine, and help reduce that number in half. And every major piece of legislation that I've introduced in city council required massive collaboration with varied interest groups, and all my major pieces of legislation I was proud to have authored got through. They were all passed.
Willie Wilson, we move on to you. 30 seconds. What approach will you use to negotiate?
Well, first of all, I think you need to give me more than 30 seconds. You went the other way, all right? Bridge coming this way, right?
Jesus.
So I just think that I need more than 30
seconds.
You've
got 20 seconds left.
But let me just say this much. I've never failed anything I've done in life, all right, in terms of business-wise, all right? But I do want to say this here. I think, getting back to the school matter for a minute, we got to pay our school teachers more dollars that they have now. We got to let them work the extra 2 months out of a year to have more income. And we got to get their particular input. And we got to take them, make that particular situation happen there with them. Otherwise, we got total chaos.
Time is up, sir.
We will stop using our kids.
Thank you, sir. Your time is
we'll
up.
Stop
We're
going
to move on to Mayor Lightfoot. Same question. What approach will you use to negotiate? 30 seconds.
A number of things. Two budget deficits were the most historic, and we got those done and passed. The largest investments in our city's history, $1.2 billion. Chicago Works, which is our multi-year, multi-billion dollar infrastructure package, a number of different union contracts. We got a Chicago casino done and civilian oversight. I could go on, but the point is we have delivered over and over again for the residents of the city through negotiations, collaboration, and delivery of services.
Okay, let's shift gears here. We're going to do another 30-second question if we can. The Chicago Coalition for the Homeless reports that 65,000 people in Chicago were homeless at the start of the pandemic. Mayor Lightfoot's Department of Housing is soliciting proposals for low-income housing Housing Tax Credit Program. Share with us your plans to help Chicagoans who are experiencing homelessness. Cam Buckner, 30 seconds.
Yeah, listen, I've talked about the increase in the real estate transfer tax of $1 million or more of those transactions, and I fought in Springfield to make sure that when the mayor came down asking for a tax increase, that we didn't give it to her because it wasn't going to go straight to people. Listen, we have a plan for permanent supportive housing, bringing back the Trouble Building Initiative, putting more money into new homes for Chicago program, and having an affordable housing czar within City Hall to actually do this work. It's not enough just to bring Chicago home. We got to do the work to keep Chicago home and make sure this is the most affordable housing-friendly city in the entire country.
Mayor Lightfoot, homelessness in Chicago, 30 seconds.
Well, I think we build on the work that we've been doing. You mentioned in the question that we are working to build more shelters, low barrier as in addition to transitional housing. We put more full-time workers into the Department of Family and Support Services. But the reality is that there's a lot of complicated reasons as to why people end up on the street. Could be financial, could be mental health, could be substance abuse, or all of the above. That's why we've made the historic investments that we've made in mental health. That's why we've made the investments that we've made in substance abuse. We've got to have an array of services to help our homeless people, and okay, that's what we're doing.
Jesus Chuy Garcia, what's your plan to combat homelessness? 30 seconds.
Housing is a human right. I support the Bring Chicago Home. We can increase the number of units that we're building in Chicago. There is a plant in my congressional district that is doing just that. They want to scale up. I would use tax increment financing, funding from the Infrastructure and Jobs Act. I would also back that up with loans and grants and subsidized loans to ensure, one, that people aren't displaced from communities that are gentrifying, and two, to speed up the production of additional housing.
Jamal Green, 30 seconds.
Yeah, we're going to make sure that we're building temporary housing for folks while we're transitioning them into affordable housing. We got to increase our affordable housing supply at record time. We knocked down project buildings and promised thousands of units. We've never seen them. So some of the things that we would do is we would give incentives to single floor commercial buildings to build on top. We would also loosen up the single family ordinance so they can build on top as well as use their basements as guarding units. We also would put in place a public bank so that we can build our own income-based housing development. Because we can have our own driver in the city of Chicago, and we can't push people out. So we want to give folks a tax credit for those folks who stay in their homes past 3 years.
Okay. Willie Wilson, how are you combat homelessness in Chicago? 30 seconds.
Well, if you look at my record past year, I done given away people who live at Tent City. I done given away hundreds of millions of dollars or hundreds of thousands of dollars to the homeless. We're giving away over $60 to $70 million of my own money, not taxpayer dollars, right, to make it happen, all right? Affordable houses, take these schools that is empty, setting up that during the winter time, create economic empowerment, people in the community do construction, make sure that work that, get the homeless off the street. When I become mayor, homeless would not exist
okay.
in the city.
All right. Sophia King, 30 seconds, homelessness.
Yeah. So affordable housing. I'll wait for the clap.
Please go ahead.
Affordable housing is the responsibility of the entire city, not just segregated parts of it. So we have to incentivize affordable housing all across the city. I would do that much like we did in the Michael Reese development, where we've got 20%, a commitment to 20% affordable housing on site. We also have to hold our governments responsible, because HUD, CHA are responsible for a lot of affordable housing stock, and we need to hold them accountable to make sure that they are being good landlords and also making sure that new stock can come through those affordable housing units.
Brandon Johnson.
Yeah, look, this is a serious problem. You know, I have a brother who died addicted and unhoused. 20,000 of our homeless population are our students. As a public school teacher, I've seen that. It's horrific. That's why the movement to bring Chicago home is behind my candidacy, to make sure that we're increasing the revenue that's actually going to deliver services for the people of the city of Chicago. Look, on the county board, I passed the Just Housing Amendment, which ended housing discrimination against those who were formerly incarcerated who were seeking housing. I built two affordable housing units in my district. We broke ground on one, a better, safer Chicago under a Johnson administration.
Roderick Sawyer, 30 seconds.
Yes, thank you. We have to do more and things differently to support our unhoused. The shelters of now, or shelters of the past, don't work now.
One particular provision I'd like to say today as it relates to Bring Chicago Home. I think it's well-intentioned, but this is the issue. We have unhoused people. In my area, I have unhoused land. I have land that's been unhoused for decades, and until we have a program that works to concentrate on rehousing the areas that we have that have no people there, and also invest in the people and the businesses there to do the same work to rehouse those areas, then we cannot support a slush fund. Thank you.
30 seconds on homelessness.
Well, quickly, you have to remove the obstacles to new housing. Secondly, you need to use TIF monies for affordable housing, and they're rarely used. Third, you have to remove obstacles for people who own apartments to convert unimproved space to garden units. You could create as many as 100,000 units. Fourth, you need to seize these 15,000 vacant residential units, turn them over to community-based organizations so that they can use them for special housing, like victims of domestic violence, et cetera, or returning citizens. Fifth, you've got to take control of the CHA. The building department, the Department of Housing really needs to be overseen and directing the CHA because they need to get into the affordable housing business.
Lourdes has our next question.
We have about 10 minutes left. This will be your last question. Here we go. Chicago politicians have long been in the headlines for their questionable decisions and flat-out corrupt behavior. Some of the candidates on this stage have faced questions around their campaign tactics and political ties. How can you convince Chicago voters to trust you? You have 60 seconds. Jamal Green, we're going to begin with you.
Well, I'm the only person on this stage that has spent all of my life in the community on the front lines for people. We have someone here on this stage at every level of government, from Congress to state to alderman to mayor to a commissioner. And where's that urgency right now in our neighborhoods? We have the opportunity to really change and bring hope to Chicago, but they're not doing it in the jobs that they are elected to. And so the reality of the situation is, do we want more of the same and politicians who are going to use this job as another ego project? Or do we want someone who really cares about all people and is going to base every policy decision off of the next generation of young people? I'm tired. I have spent half my life fighting politicians, and that's why I decided to step up today, because our young people are suffering, they're hopeless, seniors are scared to get out their cars because they're being carjacked, neighborhoods need the basic needs that they need, and that's why I'm stepping up as somebody who's saying, I'm not just trying to be a mayor for an ego project, I'm using this job to make a difference on the next generation of Chicago.
Time is up. Sophia King, your next 60 seconds. How can voters trust you?
Yeah, it's a shame that politicians, especially some on this stage, have gone to unethical behaviors because, they feel desperate. I don't know what it is. But I have a track record over the last 6.5 years and even before that of leading with not only collaboration, but with integrity and getting things done. We cannot make policy around bad people. There are bad people in every profession that we have. So I know that some of my colleagues are some of the best public servants. And like I said, over the last 6.5 years, I've led with integrity, I've led with collaboration. But not only that, I've been able to get things done while doing that. And I will continue to do that as mayor on the 5th floor.
Thank you. Cam Buckner, you're next.
Listen, the streets of Chicago are paved with broken promises. People have told the people of Chicago we're going to do one thing, and they've done another, and it's not okay. The truth of the matter is that unless a campaign in this race can make it to February 28th without being under investigation, you shouldn't consider them in the first place. And there are a couple of us who are still in that category. Listen, the people of Chicago need clear, transparent governance. And what I've been able to do in Springfield and beyond is to show people what we're doing, show them the process, and be very clear, open, honest, transparent, and accountable about it. We've not seen it in this administration. We've not seen it in previous administrations. This administration ran on one thing and then gave us another. It was like the book Animal Farm. They ran on one thing and then turned into the same thing that they were fighting against. This is not okay. It should no longer be the Chicago way. It's time for a new day.
Thank you. Willie Wilson, the question goes to you. You've got 60 seconds.
Look, I'm going to be working without a paycheck. I don't want a paycheck. I don't want a paycheck, period. I'm doing this with my heart. I'm coming out of retirement to help with my heart, right? Look at my record here, right? The city is struggling, all right? The people of Chicago are struggling very hard. They look, eggs up 50%, gasoline. People struggling hard. Well, you got a lot of people up here right now giving themselves an automatic raise. That is lunatic, right? You should not be giving yourself a raise when people are struggling, all right? People say they're struggling hard. The politician up here on this stage tonight have given themselves an automatic raise. We don't do that in corporate America. We lay people off, or you cut back, or you make ends meet. These politicians are wrong for giving themselves a raise automatically.
Time is up, sir. Brandon Johnson, your next 60 seconds.
Yeah, well, thank you again. First of all, we have to tell people the truth. And I'm the only one in this stage that has presented a budget plan that tells people the truth. I'm always going to keep it 100 with the people of the city of Chicago because we deserve that. The safest cities in America all have one thing in common. They invest in its people. That's why my budget plan calls for that. If you want a more reliable transportation system, you need someone who's prepared to invest. If you want better schools, you need someone who's prepared to invest. If you want mental health care related services, you need someone to invest. If we want to free up law enforcement from dealing with the challenges through 911 calls that are overwhelmingly mental health crises, we have to have someone who's prepared to invest. That's what my plan calls for. No one up here has been honest with the people of the city of Chicago. I'm always going to be honest with you. The fact of the matter is, if we're going to have a safe city, we cannot go back to the same old failed politics. And the politics of the 90s is how we ended up in this position. And so no matter where you are in this city, we're going to invest in you. From Inglewood to Ravenswood to Uptown to Downtown, no matter where you are, you're catching fire in one of the most dynamic campaigns that this city has seen. BrandonForChicago.com.
Paul
the city
Ballas,
of Chicago will be better
we
under
move
my
on
administration.
To you, Paul
Thank
Ballas.
You.
Thank
well,
you,
first
sir.
Of all, you have to, you have to institutionalize transparency so that when you're making an FOI request, it's actually recorded. If 10 groups want the same information, they literally have to file separately. So at the end of the day, government has to be completely transparent. Secondly, you've got to give the city council the ability to challenge the mayor's office. It just didn't begin with this mayor, it's past mayors. A real independent, autonomous budget office that has the resources to do independent analysis and access to full information, full transparency, because you need a balance of power, you need checks and balances. The third thing you have to do is you really need an independent, autonomous inspector general that can't be muzzled by any mayor and can't be muzzled by any mayor's corporation council. I think you need to consolidate the inspector general functions under a single inspector general with a 10-year term who is selected by an independent board and not necessarily selected by the mayor. And whoever that mayor is, and that inspector general needs to be able to make anything public, and they need to have subpoena power. I think those three things would provide the check and balance.
Thank you, sir. Mayor Lightfoot, you're next.
Well, we broke the rules of the machine and the status quo from day one of my administration. First day, signed an automatic prerogative executive order, which ended it. We passed the furthest-reaching ethics organization ordinance rules and made sure that people were playing by the rules. But fundamentally, you can't tell people that you're honest and that you're for them when you're dragging around corrupt politicians of the past and the present. You can't get there by taking money from a crypto king that's now indicted. You can't get there by making transactional deals with the former indicted Speaker of the House. And you can't get there by taking money from corrupt red light camera companies like Congressman Garcia. And you can't get there, Mr. Ballas, by not respecting women and being silent on hedging on whether or not women have the right to bodily autonomy. That's how you get it done. You stand up, you're a leader, you take the blows, but you are transparent and you're honest, and you stand on the side
of
the people.
Time is up, Roderick Sawyer. On to you, 60 seconds. Roderick Sawyer.
In response to your question, I lead by example. I just ask people to check my record. The 12 years I've been in city council, I did not take any money from anywhere else. I'm a licensed attorney, been a licensed attorney for 33 years, have not taken any money from any outside sources. I rely upon this. Sorry, Mr. Wilson, but I need mine, and I think my wife is out in the audience. I think she'll attest that I need mine as well. But it's important because I do the work. I want to make sure that I spent my 12 years down here doing the work, making sure doing what's important. I lead by example. I lead on the things that really are important. I contact my ethics officer all the time, make sure that I'm doing things in compliance. This is the kind of leadership that the city deserves, an honest answer. I'm the one, remember, that says I'm not going to make a commitment about taxes. Not that I won't do everything in my power not to raise them. I'm not going to make a false commitment to you if circumstances change and I might be forced to. So this is the kind of leadership you deserve, an honest leader with honest answers.
Thank
this
you.
Is what you're going to get from me.
Jesus Chuy Garcia, you're last.
Statements like the one that was just made by Lori Lightfoot is why people don't trust her and people want change in Chicago. Having said that, let me tell you about myself. I am the product of a movement for political empowerment of black and brown people in Chicago that elected Harold Washington. And over the past 40 years, I've worked to dismantle Chicago's machine. I was elected by people who trust me, and I sought to deliver for them. I delivered new schools, new playgrounds, new health clinics, many other things that the community needed. We built a new school that Paul Vallis sought to deny our community through a hunger strike that today educates children from North Lawndale and Little Village. That is the type of leader that I have been. Everything else is rumor and innuendo. My life and my political career is a testament to good ethics, to reform, to coalition building, and always to lifting up high the banner of progressivism. Thank you for your attention tonight.
Candidates, thank you. That is all the time we have for tonight.
And a special thank you to Steinmetz College Prep for hosting and the Northwest Side community organizations that joined us as well. And to our audience, we appreciate you very much.
And remember, Election Day is February 28th. Stay with us here on WGN. We'll have a post-forum breakdown coming up in 2 minutes.
This weekend only at